week's episode of Tech and Tequila, where we interview the smartest founders and funders in India over tequila-based drinks. Cheers.
Cheers. Thank you very much. We are joined today by Satyan Kothari. You know, there are not a lot of people, right, who, you know, a lot of people call themselves serial entrepreneurs. And you actually feel like you've earned that title, right? You know, from way back in when you first started Trapezo and then SunTrue and then with Citrus Pay and Cube. You know, let's roll it back to the very start of that journey, you know, right after Stanford, right after Frog. Tell us about how you sort of made that transition and, you know, became an entrepreneur.
Right. So the funny thing is, Adam, I swore to myself when I went to Stanford that I'd never be an entrepreneur.
They want to be the cliche.
No, more than that, I'd seen my dad be an entrepreneur and how hard it was. I said, this is my ticket to freedom. A nice fat US dollar based salary, right? I want that house with the garage and two cars and
the Oh wow, the real pool. American
the
dream.
Archetype.
The real suburban American
oh,
dream.
Oh wow, that is my nightmare, just FYI.
Yes, but for me, that was the ultimate goal, right, of getting there. And it's funny, Stanford has this infectious quality where
you
just get surrounded by this energy. And before I knew it, 3 years after graduation, 1999, I took off with my boss at that time at Frog Design. I said, let's start a company. And that's what I've been doing for 19 years now.
You really aged yourself in this very moment.
Excellent.
but kind of.
Thanks. Thanks, child.
You're welcome. So kind of bringing it to Citrus Pay, it was one of the rare large exits in the Indian tech ecosystem. Can you kind of walk us through that process, what it was like to come to that decision with your team, and just any details that you can provide?
So Citrus was an amazing journey, right? From start to finish, I think we got very lucky to kind of use the playbook of a startup.
Right.
We started with a very simple mission saying, payments in India is broken. Let's start something with a design and software angle. We got very lucky to get initial backing. We were ready to actually fund it ourselves for the first 6 months. We were funding it ourselves.
Okay.
The first person we hired was being paid. First 10 people were being hired from our personal savings accounts.
Right.
A lot of things have to click in terms of strategy, execution, but also luck, pure luck for it to work. And we got very lucky. We made some mistakes. Luckily, the mistakes weren't fatal enough,
mm-hmm.
though we all know we tried really hard to kill ourselves a few times as a company. I think what clicked was this experience of having started a couple of companies to know that there's a finite outcome we are aiming for, right? It's not a business that we want to do for the next 20 years just because it's
so that was very clear.
It was very clear to all of us saying, the way payments is moving, it's not a sustainable long-term business. It's really about fixing the problem in the moment.
Okay.
And that goes down into the details to the next level, for example, about how much capital we should raise.
Right.
Right. If we had overcapitalized ourselves, it would have been very difficult to get exits for all our investors.
Right.
So what is very widely misreported, and I'm happy to go on record for the first time, is Citrus didn't raise $32 million. It actually raised $22 million. And we had $4 million in the bank when we sold.
Okay.
So effectively at an $18 million capitalization, we had built a company that was at its time of sale doing about a $2 billion in payment run rate. Right? So it was built saying we don't want to go out on the road.
Sure.
We need to sell it at some point. All our investors need to get a good return.
Sure. And I hate to force broader lessons out of specific instances, like trying to force a narrative upon, you know, how you saw your career as, you know, very specific problem and need based experiences that you just ran into, you know, at a particular moment. But, you know, exits is a thing that people sort of still obsess about in the Indian ecosystem because it doesn't happen a lot. People wonder how, you know, that can be achieved generally and how founders and funders alike work around that particular aspect of the startup ecosystem. Is there anything that you find to be something that's truly learnable for others?
So, you know, all entrepreneurs celebrate when they get a funding round, right?
Right.
What most people forget is when you take a funding round, it's an obligation to give a return to your investors. Your investors are not doing it because they want to necessarily build a dream company.
Sure.
As a founder, you can have that vision saying, I want to build the next Google for 20 years, etc. But you have an obligation to people like Sandeep to say, you need to get a return back. And investors typically have a finite time frame in which you need to get them a return, right? So the moment you take money, you need to have this understanding of the dynamics of the partner you're bringing on board, in this case, the venture capitalist. If you miss that, you get into a lot of trouble that leads to boardroom tensions, bad decisions being made at the founder level. And I think that's the learning I've had from my first startup, where I didn't have any clue about all these dynamics. I was very lucky to have SoftBank as a investor in 2001, and I didn't know what. I just was naive in thinking, oh, I want to build this forever, and so should they. They should have the same mission, right. And that's not fair on them.
So kind of broadening this conversation about exits, do you think the scarcity of exits in the Indian tech landscape today holds the entire ecosystem back a little? And do you think this will change a little bit over the next couple of years, where you see, you know, bigger MNCs that are India-based look to make those acquisitions, similar to how we see the M&A landscape in the US kind of just exploding?
All of the Indian multinationals, the banks, I think are missing out on a big opportunity to pick up some incredible talent and opportunities by writing smaller checks compared to the market caps they have, right? And if we see that movement, I think you're going to see the next huge wave of Indian entrepreneurship and Indian product companies leading the world. Because now the government's laying down the pipes with UPI, NAC, and everything to make, at least in fintech, something explode, right? So how do you encourage those guys? It can't just be a Sandeep at Nexus. It also needs a buyer sitting there saying, look, I'm going to write a few checks, an Amazon, a Flipkart. Let's even leave aside the Infosys, right? I wish Flipkart and Amazon were making more purchases in the small single-digit dollar range.
You do see Google kind of looking to Hyderabad and a couple of the smaller Bangalore-based startups and kind of investing or acqui-hiring in some degree.
Google's never been accused of not being progressive, I suppose.
It is not.
It's a Stanford company.
Yeah.
Fine, guys. Stanford is great. Okay.
On the topic of progress, let's progress now to our favorite part of the show, Truth and Tequila.
Here are all our tequila shots.
Okay.
To refresh you on the rules, Satyen, it's very simple. Either you tell the truth or you take a shot.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Adam loves that interruption.
I love it.
You have it down pat. So tell us, Satyen, was there any friction when you spun Cube out of Citrus Pay?
Is silence an answer?
No,
okay, just checking. Yes, there was, right? And I think that's okay. I think when you have multiple founders, at times you have differences of opinion. Mm-hmm. It's very healthy in general. I think what happened is that you had two different sets or types of founding team members. The original premise behind Citrus was to build a better mousetrap, a better payment gateway. Right, and so it needed to be a sales execution engine on top of software. And we were doing a good job on that. And then when we started formulating the idea of Cube, it was definitely a very, very much of a concept play. Right. So it's not necessary that somebody who's very good at building an engine can understand the instinct to take a big leap of faith. Right, if you look at a Facebook, right, and we've all seen the social network, there's Mark saying, I'm not ready to launch, even though his roommates are telling him go. Right? And there's a big, big faith instinct-based thing saying this feels right now. I think that's what we were facing. And to our credit, we decided to take it to the board. It was emotional. And we gave the board three options, and the board picked one, the external board. And we said, okay, let's go with this.
That sounds like some healthy conflict resolution right there.
It wasn't healthy, but it was conflict resolution.
So have you been able to remain on good terms with all of the founders?
So I stayed on the board of Citrus till the sale. Okay. But you know, sometimes when it's your baby, you do get emotional. Okay. And I just said, you know, it's better that the journey ended the way it did.
So to speak, who do you like / dislike the most out of the rest of your co-founders?
Let's drink. I finally got a drink.
Yeah, she had to ad-lib that one too because she knew it.
I know.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to, you know, take some of your advice and ask slightly...
You should ask hard questions. Yeah.
Contentious questions.
Let's ask some funny questions too. What's the most baller thing you've spent your exit on?
You know, I haven't really, Adam. And it's weird to say this because, you know, by the time I did Citrus, it wasn't so much about the money. I just realized I was an addict to startups, right? Sure. So when the check hit the bank, and I was like, this is good. It does liberate you from thinking about everyday things, saying, hey, do I need to check 3 airfares before I fly on a holiday, right? You don't need to do that. But apart from that, it's been good. I mean, I loved racing cars, but luckily I'd bought my dream car before the exit. So I'm pretty satisfied.
What is that car?
It's a beautiful little, the last of the naturally aspirated Porsche Cayman GTSs.
Okay. Yeah. Not that I know what that is, but great.
Google it, people.
Do you regret leaving or selling any of the companies that you have founded at the time that you did?
Do I regret it at that time when I was selling it?
Yeah.
Citrus was an absolutely beautifully timed exit. I'm so happy I managed to convince the board, and the other people also agreed it was right. We would have been in a big mess if we had not sold by now. Mm-hmm. We would have been complaining on Twitter about WhatsApp getting into payments with everybody else. I think the third company I had was a consulting startup, and I really liked the quality of experience I was getting working with large and small companies. It was a great play. That's when I came to know Sandeep, and he thought I was retired because I was so relaxed and enjoying my work, right? I'd worked nights for US companies, just learning and making good money. So that was a tough one to say, should I give that great life up?
So why did you?
I had one foot in India, and I realized I needed to commit to this country and do something here. I was kind of really being a little cowardly by saying, hey, I'll enjoy my business in San Fran, but live out here.
Yeah. I'm just picking up on something you had sort of dropped earlier, that within the Citrus board and that conversation that was happening when, you know, the offer had come in, were you sort of a leading voice and actually advising for the sale? And how did that conversation evolve internally?
Absolutely, I was, right? I wanted to sell it for a few reasons. Some professional, some personal, some strategic. As I said, the UPI movement was very clear in my head. I remember in 2015 when it was launched, and a reporter called me, and I was at Hyderabad airport, and I just read it on my phone in the taxi, and I had no answers. I'm like, this is the end, dude. I mean, I can see it. I don't know when it'll happen because it's a government protocol, but this is trouble. So by 2016, it was clear to me we needed to get out. Second, I'm an entrepreneur, right? I was on the board of Citrus, but I felt a little out of control with what was on paper my biggest wealth creation, right?
Right, while you were still trying to get Cube conceptualized and out there.
Right. So Cube, I have irrational optimism, right, that I can pull off things. So I wasn't worried about the Cube part. I was just that this is not in my DNA to be a passive member of a board, mm-hmm. right? I need to be in the thick of things, or I need to get out. And obviously, when we had split up, we had disagreements of how the company should be run. Mm-hmm. And that's why I wasn't comfortable with the way it was being run either. So multiple things added up. And then obviously what we discussed, saying in India, you don't get exits that fast. Right. Like, dude, somebody's paying us 850 crores after 5 years, right? Let's take the check. I mean, let's not be idiotic about this. Yeah.
So I guess bringing it to Cube, since we kind of touched on the subject a little bit here and there, what can you tell us about it? I know it's in private beta right now, but can you give us some details around what exactly you're building?
Great. First, let me answer the main question that I'm sure your audience has. What's this amazing t-shirt about, right?
Oh yeah. Oh,
right?
We've been thinking about that.
Yeah.
For the whole
episode.
That blue. Yeah, so that blue and the slogan. And so let's read it. Bank on Cube. And should I show the back?
Yes, please.
Right?
Do.
So build the bank of the future.
Nice.
Right? And that's the setting for Cube when you think about it.
All the 12 people watching this will really know what Cube is.
Those 12 will be richer than any crypto investors. Just watch. So on a serious note, we have this really obsolete institution, which is around our legacy financial systems. Mm-hmm. And when you think about it, it's all of us are servants to it, right? Our money goes at the end of the month in a bank account. Right. It sits there till we decide to do something. And when you decide to do something, you have to learn on money control what to do with it, right? That's super confusing. And then you get scared, so you don't do anything with it. And so you leave it sitting there, and it just is extremely inefficient. And hence, all the Lower Parel and BKC towers are built on our money, and the interest they're earning. So one realization was that this whole thing needs an update where software and design can be used to automate everything around money, right? And then the second part that was an aha moment was actually tied to the Citrus sale, where once I had money in the bank, all these wealth managers started coming, right? Coming to me. And I'm like, man, all these guys know how to make money, but they never called me for the first 40 years of my life, right? And some of them are really smart, some are complex and scammy, but some are really sharp people who really know how to make the rich really a lot richer. I said, this fundamentally doesn't feel good in the sense that how is this product not available to everybody else? So Cube is doing two things, right? It's saying, let software automate everything you need to do around your money, right? Whether it's to handle your bills, your staff salaries, whether you're budgeting for a trip to Paris in the summer, how do you plan all of that? While you're doing all of it, that money shouldn't sit in a bank account. It should earn you 6.5-7% with very regulated, protected instruments. And on the wealth side, how do you put in modern forms of creating wealth through new asset classes? So in Cube today, you will have a curated list of very simplified mutual funds, which are broken down by risk and return, right? You don't need to go through multiple variables. We've done all of that. Something we've just introduced is equity advisory platform, which normally wasn't available to anybody who didn't want to put in a crore. And now it can be available as little as a monthly SIP of $20,000. So, you know, you can have a 25, 30-year-old who wants that quality of advice, and that's a fund which is giving it, providing equity advice to the ultra HNIs of India today. Right. I can't name them, but these are people worth thousands of crores. How would you like to have that same advice at $20,000 a month, right? And they're all services that I personally vet, I personally put my personal money in before I say this is ready for the Cube customer base.
Now, you know, it seems like you've come in with an approach where you're almost building a new building on top of and offering that to the customer as opposed to maybe integrating and improving what's already there. Now, I'm sure that that wasn't a deliberate choice, right? Walk through how that works in your mind and how that makes it more challenging for customer acquisition, for actually building a product that is so much better that any replacement cost or inertia or marketing is overcome, you know, by virtue of its improved value?
It's a great question. It's a complex multi-point question that you threw in there. You know, when we started Citrus, we made one rule, right? Don't complain about the Indian regulator, right? If you're going to complain about it, nothing's going to work here. I mean, we complain on Twitter for fun to provoke people, but you just can't. You have to accept the way things are and build around them. Right. So at Cube, for example, we've integrated and partnered with over 15 entities. Saying it's not in fintech, we are the tech. We are not the financial experts. So we get the right pipes and the right experts and the right systems, even though they might be old legacy systems. And we say, how can we best integrate with them? So we integrated with BSE Star, which is the Bombay Stock Exchange switch. We've integrated through very modern APIs at Zerodha. We've integrated with Milap for micro lending, right? We've integrated with BBPS, which is the new format for bill payments in India. But we've also integrated with proprietary bill payment aggregators like BillDesk, who used to run before BBPS. Because it's not our job to pick the winner. Our job is to service the customer. I want to take care of your bill. I want to put your mutual fund order in play right away. If Bombay Stock Exchange is going to be down for 3 hours, that shouldn't be your problem. Our algorithms figure out how to delay the order till the system's up, right? It's not always easy because a lot of these players aren't equipped for the kind of demands we are putting. But wherever possible, we mask it from the user. Like, you know, we wanted to do a blockchain-based universal KYC when we started in 2016. And we have a blockchain. And we're going to turn it off. Because guess what? In 2 years, India's not ready to adopt a universal KYC format, right? But we tried. And we were hopeful, and that's part of our job, right, as innovators to say, maybe this will pick up. So 9 times out of 10, you might be slightly wrong, and it's okay.
Sure.
So sort of broadening out that question a little bit, where do you see the opportunities in fintech in India sort of evolving in the next 5 to 10 years?
Yeah, and how, you know, aside from, you know, directly relevant to the place that Cube hopes to disrupt, how does personal banking and personal finance really look like for the average Indian in 5 years?
I think it's literally the most amazing time to be in India if you're in fintech. I'll tell you why, right? Because you can slice and dice even the top 500 million users in so many small parcels. And each of them have very unique needs. Right. I mean, you talk about the big craze that's been on since the last couple of years around lending, mm-hmm. right? Right? And there are loan sizes needed from 500 rupees to 50 lakhs, mm-hmm. right? And there's somebody at 50 lakhs who's well deserving, who's actually a very low risk compared to maybe a 500 rupee guy,
right?
Right? So there's so many different approaches to take that way. I think the same thing is going to happen in personal banking and wealth, which is there are stratas of society which understand and have very different needs. So you're going to have a Paytm Wealth, which is going to be very different from a Kotak's wealth management, which is going to be very different from a Cube's wealth management feature, because they're catering to a wide audience which speaks a different language, thinks in a different way about money, right? So you can have what a lot of the robo-advisory guys are doing today is saying mutual funds.
Right.
You're like, that's great, right? We don't see a lot of differentiation there. But what are we throwing at our users? We are saying, hey, do you know you can buy a property for 5 lakhs earning you interest in Bangalore, right? And we've done the research,
right?
Cryptocurrencies, all the craze, this is the right exchange you should have bought it on when it was still allowed. Because we've analyzed who has the lowest brokerage fees and the highest liquidity. Things that a normal consumer doesn't need to think about, right? Liquidity, who knows why that's important, but we do that. So we apply all those because our customer is a mass affluent urban professional. We're not catering to the guy in a tier 2 town. Somebody else should cater to them. It's a very valid market.
Right. Yeah, but on that note, thank you so much, Satyen, for spending time and helping us learn a little bit more about what it takes to start and maintain a lot of these different companies.
Thank you. And any last shots of advice potentially?
To entrepreneurs everywhere, do it for the right reasons. It's a hard journey. It gets simpler to make decisions, but it never gets easier, right? So don't do it because it's sexy and because everybody in economic times is talking about entrepreneurs. Do it because you truly believe in it. But once you do it, it's an adrenaline rush, and be prepared, you can't get off that ride.
Cool. Here.
Cheers to that. Yeah,
cheers
Thanks
to
so
entrepreneurs
much,
and both of you.
Thank you.